Hello everyone, myself Kamini, and today in the module of medical biochemistry, I'll be talking about the chemistry of proteins and amino acids. So in today's lecture, the outline is all about so what are the proteins and the biomedical importance, in which specifically we study about the definition, the biochemical definition of a protein, and how there are biomedical importance of protein, and then we will also learn about their composition. And then we will talk about the amino acids, their classification and properties in detail. We will talk about what are amino acids, we'll learn their basic structure, how do they are classified, what are the non-standard and the standard amino acids, what are their occurrence, and there are like essential amino acids, semi-essential, non-essential, you must have heard about. We will also study about their functions and physical and the chemical properties as well. Then in the next section, we will learn the classification of proteins and as well as their properties. That includes their based on their size, shape, solubility, functions, and in terms of the property, we will talk about both physical and the chemical. And then finally, we will talk about the structure of the proteins. So in the structure of the proteins, we will talk about their primary structure, secondary structure, and in the secondary structure, what are the linkages, what are the types, such as alpha helix, beta pileated structure, random coil structure. We will also talk about the tuft-free structure, what are the bonds which are involved in tuft-free structure formation. We will also talk about the quaternary structures and what are the bonds that make it, and we will cover it with a few examples. In the structure, we will also talk about the protein denaturation and what are the various factors that cause the denaturation, what are the applications and the changes of a protein molecule when it undergoes after the denaturations. And also, you can study about the criteria of the purity of the protein. So if we start with a basic introduction about the protein, in 1839, Dutch chemist G.J. Mulder, he, while investigating substances such as which are basically found in milk, like for example, egg, that found that could be coagulated when you heat them. And there are certain nitrogenous compounds. So that's how they were investigating. Now the Swedish scientist J.J. Bergelius suggested to Mulder that these substances should be called proteins. And the term is derived from the Greek word proteos, which means primary or holding first place. So that's how the protein name has come up. And now we know the proteins are the fundamental structural components of the body. They are also called the nitrogenous macromolecules because they're composed of many amino acids. And in general, these proteins are the most versatile macromolecules which are in the living systems, and they serve crucial function in essentially all biological processes. So for example, these are the major functions that has been performed by protein. Like they can act as a catalyst. They play a very important role in the transport and store other molecules. For example, oxygen. You must have heard about the hemoglobin. And then they provide mechanical support, immune protection, for example, the antibodies. And for the mechanical support, you have a lot of microfilaments, microtubules. Those proteins are very much required for the basic functions. And then they generate the movement, transmit the nerve impulses. They are also responsible for controlling a lot of growth and the differentiations. And now if you look at certain boxes, which I can show you in this slide. So in general, proteins, they are composed of carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, sulfur, phosphorus, copper, iron, etc. They are considered as the unbranched polymers of alpha amino acids. They are also considered as a necklace of amino acids. And if you look at the basic structure of protein, which majorly, so these are proteins can be proteins in general, if I could say, the nitrogen content is around 16% of the molecular weight of the protein. And there are very few amounts of sulfur and the phosphorus are present. And few proteins contain other elements such as iodine, copper, manganese, zinc, iron, etc. as I've already mentioned. Protein molecules are very large molecules with a very high molecular weight that range from 5000 to 2500 kilodalton. So that's the protein can be broken down into the very smaller units that is done by the hydrolysis. And these small units are basically known as the monomers of protein, and they are called as amino acids. So in general, proteins are made up of from 20 amino acids. These are the standard amino acid, which we will talk about in detail in the upcoming slides. So they have again different sequences in the numbers. So there is always an indefinite number of proteins that can be formed and do occur in nature. And thus proteins are considered as the unbranched polymers of L-alpha amino acid, as we already mentioned. So now if you look at the right hand of this bottom of this slide, this is the general formula for any L-alpha amino acid, which is shown here. So here R is called a side chain and can be a hydrogen, aliphatic, aromatic or heterocyclic group. Each amino acid has an amino group, which is NH2. A carboxylic acid group, COOH, and a hydrogen atom, which is attached to a carbon located next to the carboxyl group. So thus the side chain varies from one amino acid to the other. And now we will talk about what are the amino acids and what are their classification and in structure. So in general, when proteins hydrolyze either by boiling with the acids or through the action of certain specific enzymes, they are broken down into their component amino acids. And the amino acids are of the A form, that is the amine group, which is attached to the carbon atom, which is next to the carboxyl group. R is generally called a side chain, as I've already mentioned. And as so this is already, I have summarized this slide, that the amino acids are classified as having a nonpolar, polar and acidic in the basic in nature. So these are the basically three groups depending on their reaction within the solution also. So they can be neutral, they can be acidic and basic as well. Now, if you look at here, these are the list of amino acids which are classified. For example, glycine, alanine, valine, leucine, methionine and isoleucine. They come under the category of non-polar aliphatic R groups. So if you look at here, this R group is completely different in all these amino acids. Then we have aromatic R groups, which are phenylalanine, tyrosine, tryptophan. So you must have heard that when the person is wanted to quantify the protein. So these are the three amino acids which are basically plays a very important role during that determination, because at a particular wavelength, these molecules are absorbed, and then you can do the spectrophotometric analysis of the protein. Now we have the polar uncharged R groups. So the examples are serine, threonine, cysteine, proline, asparagine, and glutamine. Then we have a certain positively charged R groups, which is lysine, arginine, and histidine. Then we have negatively charged R groups, and these are involved. The examples are aspartate and glutamate. So these are the amino acids which we were discussing. So like for example, aliphatic amino acid, as I mentioned, this is the glycine, which is the amino acid known as optically inactive. Then we have alanine, which is also known as the alpha amino propionic acid. So like that, we have different amino acids. All of the above, they are considered the simple monoamino monocarboxylic acids. So on the basis of their structure, they are classified. Now, if we look at for the non-standard amino acids, the compounds which are similar to basic structure of the amino acids, but they do not occur in the proteins. So this is a list of examples. For example, the beta-alanine, which is found in coenzyme A. Then we have taurine, which is found in the bile acids. The another is ornithine and citrulline. They are considered as the intermediates in the urea cycle. Then we have thyroid hormones you must have heard about. So those are thyroxine, T4 and triiodothyronine. That's T3, which are synthesized from tyrosine amino acid. Then we have GABA, which is a alpha-aminobutyric acid. It's a neurotransmitter which is produced from the amino acid glutamic acid. Then we have beta-aminoisobutyric acids. These are the end product of the nucleotide. That's the pyrimidine metabolism. We have intermediates in the heme synthesis, which is the delta amino linoleic acid. We have methionine, acetinosyl methionine, which are the methyl donor that are formed from the L-methionine. And we have a DOPA. So this is the 3-dihydroxyphenylalanine, which is considered as a precursor for the melanin pigment. Apart from that, we have D amino acids. These are isolated from the animal and plants, which are called L amino acid. But certain D amino acids are found in bacteria and antibiotics, and as well as in the brain tissues of the animals. The examples are D glutamic acid and D alanine, which are the constituents of the bacterial cell wall. Then we have the amino acids, which are found in certain antibiotics, for example, gramicidine S, actinomycin D. And we have animal tissues, which contain the L amino acids, which are deaminated by L amino acid oxidase. We have D amino acids like D aspartate and D serine, which are found in the brain tissue. So these are the classes which comes under the D amino acid and the non-standard amino acids. Now, what are the essential and the non-essential amino acids? So, nutritionally, amino acids are of two types, which are categorized into essential and non-essential. And there is also a third group, which is called the semi-essential amino acids. So, essential amino acids are the ones which are not synthesized by the body and they have to be taken in the diet. They include valine, leucine, isoleucine, threonine, phenylalanine, lysine, tryptophan, and methionine. So, if you want to remember the example for the essential amino acid, you can just memorize like Matt will fully. Now we have non-essential amino acids. They can be synthesized by the body and may not be the request components of the diet. Then we have they are already synthesized by the body, so it is not necessary that you have to have a diet which includes these amino acids. Then we have semi-essential amino acids. These are basically considered as a growth promoting factors since they are not synthesized in sufficient quantity during growth. For example, histidine and arginine, they become essential when there is a growth of a children during the pregnancy and also majorly in the lactating women. Now, there are also new amino acids. In addition to the 20L amino acids that take part in the protein synthesis, there are two new amino acids that has been described. That is the selenocysteine, which is considered as the 21st amino acid. And it occurs at the active site of several enzymes. Though the examples are thioredoxin reductase, glutathione peroxide, which scavenges the peroxides. We have a deiodinase that converts thyroxine to another T3 thyroid hormone. Then we have a glycine reductase, which is another enzyme. Then we have a selenoprotein P, which is a glycoprotein that contains 10 selenocysteine residues, and this is generally found in the mammalian blood because it has a very important antioxidant function. So if you look at this reaction, this is the structure of the selenocysteine, and in the presence of the ATP molecules, there's an enzyme called selenophosphate synthetase. In a simpler way, the reaction that occurs, this is a selenium molecule, this is the ATP molecule, synthetase converts into the selenocysteine phosphate molecule. Then in the presence of serine, it becomes selenocysteine by the release of the inorganic phosphate. Now the second example is for the new amino acid is the pyrrolysine, which is a 22nd amino acid. So here the stop codon UAG can code for the pyrrolysine. Now we come to the properties of the amino acids. The first property we discuss about here is the isomerism. There are two types of isomerism that are shown by amino acids, basically due to the presence of asymmetric carbon atom. And glycine is an example which has no asymmetric carbon atom in its structure. Hence, it is known as the optically inactive amino acid. Then we have another property that, which is a part of isomerism. That's the stereoisomerism. So here, all amino acids except glycine, they exist in D and the L isomers. So we have already described in the chapter on the carbohydrates that it's absolute configuration. So what happens in the D amino acid, the NH2 group is on the right hand, while in L amino acids, it is oriented to the left. So it is the same orientation of the hydroxyl group of the central carbon of glyceraldehyde. So this is the figure. It shows the L and the D amino acid. Now we have, so generally the natural proteins of animals and plants, they generally contain L amino acid. However, D amino acids occur in the bacteria that I've already discussed in the previous slides. Now the another is the optical isomerism, that in which the optical activity depends on the pH and the side chain. And here, all amino acids except glycine, they have a symmetric carbon atom. There are few amino acids like isoleucine and threonine, they have an additional asymmetric carbon in their structure. Consequently, all but glycine exhibit the optical activities, and they have an ability to rotate the plane polarized light so that they can exist in the dextrorotatory or a levorotatory isomers. Now we have amphoteric nature and the isoelectric pH. You must have heard about the ampholytes. So in that case, the NH2 and the carboxylic group of amino acids, they are ionizable group. So it depends on the pH of the solution. These groups can act as a proton donors or a proton acceptor, that is acids or bases respectively. And here the another further, so you have a charge polar side chains of few amino acids also ionized. So as I mentioned, depending on the pH, this property is overall called as amphoteric, and therefore amino acids are also called as ampholytes. At a specific pH, the amino acid carries both the charges in equal number, and they exist as a dipolar ion, or you can also know called as deuterion. In that case, the net charge on the particular amino acid becomes zero. So that's how, in that case, the positive and the negative charges on that protein or a particular amino acid molecule equalizes. And the pH at which this occurs without any charge on it, it's called its isoelectric point or isoelectric pH. Now, on the acidic sides of its isoelectric point of an amino acid exists as a cation, which accepts a proton, and on an alkaline, it acts as an anion by donating a proton. And this property is very much useful when you have to purify the proteins. So this property of this isoelectric pH, isoelectric point, acceptance of proton and donating a proton, this property is very useful during the isolation or and the purification of the proteins. Now, there are certain chemical properties which are majorly due to the carboxyl group. For example, first is the formation of esters. They can form esters with alcohols. For example, treatment with the sodium carbonate solution in the cold that releases the free ester from the ester hydrochloride, and that results in the formation of the esters. Then we have a reduction to amino alcohol. This is achieved in the presence of lithium aluminium hydride. That is the formation of amine that happens due by the decarboxylation reaction. Here is an enzyme called decarboxylase, and there is a dry distillation which converts an amino acid into an amine. There is also a formation of amides. That is, there is a conversion from amino acid ester to amino acid amide. So these are the reactions which happens due to the presence of carboxyl group. So we have a chemical property which are majorly due to the amino group. There is first the salt formation, that is with acids. Here the basic amino group react with the mineral acids, such as glycine can react with HCl, which forms the glycine hydrochlorides. Then there is a formation of acyl derivatives. Here amino group can react with the acyl anhydride or acyl halides such as benzoyl chloride, or and that can give the acyl amino acids like benzoyl glycine. Incidentally, this is one of the mechanisms of detoxification in which glycine is used, and this also forms the basis of one of the liver function test. Now we have a reaction with the HNO2. This forms the basis of Wendt's lysate method for determining the NH2 group. If somebody wanted to determine the NH2 group of an amino acid or a protein, so this reaction can be used. Then we have a reaction with formaldehyde. Here, formaldehyde can react with the amino group, results in the formation of the methylene compound, and this is an application that it is used in the Sorensen's formal titration methods. Then we have a properties which is both due to amino and the carboxyl group. Here the amino acids form the chelated coordinated complexes with certain heavy metals and other ions. So for example, that can include copper, cobalt, manganese and the calcium. So the clinical application for this property is that the chelates are the non-ionic and therefore amino acids may be used if you wanted to remove calcium from the bones and teeth. So this is the standard application which you use in the clinics. Now we have now we will talk about the peptides and proteins. So here in the peptides and protein, there are 20 amino acids which are commonly found in protein, and these 20 amino acids are basically linked through peptide bond, forming peptide and the proteins. So peptides are generally, they are composed of only a small number of amino acids when they are joined as a peptide bond. They are named according to the number of amino acids present in them. So here, these are the two amino acids. There is a hydroxylation happens. So there is a release of the water molecule, and that it results in the formation of this CONH bond between the two amino acids, which is called the peptide bond. Now the examples could be dipeptide, which is the aspartame, that's the sweetener, artificial sweetener. Then we have glutathione, that's the tripeptide. Then we have vasopressin and the oxytocin hormone, these are the octapeptides. We have insulin, which is a polypeptide molecule. So what are the characteristics of peptide bond? The carbon-nitrogen backbone bonds in each peptide group have some double bond character and they do not rotate. The other backbone bonds, they designated as the C-alpha N or C-alpha C, and they are theoretically free to rotate since they are true single bonds. These are the Ramachandran angles, which are basically the angle of rotation of the C-alpha N, which is called the phi angle, and the other one is called the psi angle because there is a rotation at the C-alpha to C. So for any given pair of phi and psi angles, one can predict whether the conformation is allowed or not, and that is the property of the Ramachandran plot. Now, what are the biological important peptides? So some small peptides which have significant biological activity, they are formed as a result of hydrolysis of large proteins, while some are formed by synthesis. Then, for example, glutathione, these are the tripeptide, consists of glutamic acid, glycine and cysteine. They play a very important role in oxidation and reduction systems. We have carnosine, which are water-soluble dipeptides of voluntary muscle. We have bradykinin, which involves 10 amino acids, and they act as a relaxant effects, majorly on the smooth muscles. And then we have antibiotics. So we have a lot of like penicillin, gramicidine, actinomycin, chloramphenicol. They all are peptides which act as the antibiotics. We have peptides which are synthesized by microbial agents like bleomycin that can be used therapeutically as the antitumor agent. We have gastrin, secretin and pancreozymin. These are the gastrointestinal peptides which act as hormones that plays a very important role in the stimulation of bile secretion and also the other enzymes of the digestive system. Now, what are the amino acid metabolism disorders? So there's like one is a major is phenylketonuria. This is caused by a lack of phenylalanine hydroxylase. This needed to convert the phenylalanine to tyrosine, and it can be lead to intellectually disability, seizures, behavioral problems, and the mental disorders. We have a homocystinuria, which is caused by a lack of the enzyme cystathione beta synthase, which is needed to metabolize homocystine, and due to the absence of this enzyme, there's a lot of accumulation of homocystinuria. We have maple syrup urine disease. This is an autosomal recessive metabolic disorder which affects the branch chain amino acids. So here, people with this condition, they cannot break down the amino acids leucine, isoleucine, and valine. So there's a lot of accumulation. Then we have classic, which is a type 1 or a hepatorenal. It's a tyrosinemia, which is caused by a deficiency of fumaryl acetoacetate hydrolase. And this is the last enzyme, which is required in the thyroxine catabolism. There are severe liver disease, which are, in that case, there's unsatisfactory weight gain, peripheral anomalies, and the kidney defects. Now, we have talked about the classification of amino acids. Now we will talk about the classification of proteins. So proteins are classified on the basis of their size and the shape, on the basis of their functional properties, and on the basis of the physical properties and their solubility. So if we define on the basis of classified on the basis of the shape and size. These are the fibrous and the globular proteins. Fibrous proteins, when the axial ratio of length or width, a length to the width of a protein molecule is more than 10, is called a fibrous protein. For example, these proteins are found in hair. For example, alpha keratin, collagen comes under the fibrous proteins category. We have in case of a globular protein, the axial ratio of a length to width of a protein molecule is less than 10, and it is called as a globular protein. It's, for example, hemoglobin, which carries the oxygen, myoglobin, then we have ribonuclease, etc. If we classify it on the basis of functional properties, so there are defense proteins, for example, immunoglobulins, which are involved in the defense mechanism. Contractile proteins, these are the major protein of the skeletal muscle and involved in the muscle contraction and relaxation. Respiratory proteins, they are involved in the function of respiration, like hemoglobin, myoglobin, cytochromes. We have structural proteins, which are proteins of skin, cartilage, or nail. Now, on the basis of solubility and physical properties, they are divided into three classes. One is the simple proteins. These are proteins which, on complete hydrolysis, yield only amino acids, and they can be further subclassified, like how they are solubilized and on the basis of their solubilities and the heat coagulabilities. So, depending on the size and the shape, so the major subclasses of these proteins are protamines. These are small molecules soluble in water, acids, alkalis, and diluted ammonia. Do not contain cysteine, tryptophan, and tyrosine, but they are highly rich in arginine, can be combined with nucleic acid, and can form the nucleoproteins. So, the examples are salmine or sardinine. There are certain cyprinine of these fish, sperms, and the testes. Then we have albumins. These are the proteins which are very much soluble in water and in dilute salt solutions. They are coagulable by heat and are changed to products that are insoluble in water and solutions of salt. You must have, the egg albumin. So we have albumins which have low isoelectric pH of pI 4.7, and therefore they are very acidic proteins at the pH 7.4. The physiological pH, they are generally deficient in glycine. Examples, plant albumins, that is leguminin in legumes, and in cereals, it's leucosine. Animal source are lactoalbumin in milk and oval albumin in egg. Now, the another is histones. These are very much rich in arginine and histine, basic proteins. They can conjugate with nucleic acids and porphyrins. They are nucleohistones, chromosomal nucleoproteins, and globin of hemoglobin. Now we have scleroprotein. These are fibrous proteins with greater stability and very low solubility, which forms the supporting structure of animals. The examples are keratins, collagens, and elastins. And they are basically differentiated on the basis of what is the polypeptide chain, it's the helical structure. They are found in hair, nails. Collagens are mostly the structure is one-third structure is glycine. Then we have proline and hydroxyproline with 1% hydroxylysine. Then we have elastins, which are very much rich in non-polar amino acids, and they are present in the connective tissue, ligaments, and tendons, and they are formed in large amount in the uterus during the pregnancy. Now we have conjugated proteins. These are the proteins which, in addition to amino acids, contains a non-protein group called prosthetic group in the structure. These are the basic examples: nucleoproteins, lipoproteins, glycoproteins, and phosphoproteins. And these are the examples under these category. Then we have a general properties of proteins, like the taste. They are generally tasteless. They are the hydrolytic products, bitter in taste. If they are hydrolytic, they are odorless. When heated to dryness, they turn brown and give off the odor of burning feather. And the molecular weight, they are generally large molecular weight proteins called as macromolecules. Molecular weight is determined by physical methods such as depression in freezing point, osmotic pressure measurement, light scattering effect, X-ray refraction, turbidity measurement. Now, there are a lot of methods which can determine the molecular weight. The basic we know, that is a gel filtration chromatography. There are analytical ultracentrifuges, STS page, through which you can actually determine and calculate the molecular weight of a protein. Now, we have a heat coagulation, that is maximum at the isoelectric pH of a particular protein. And during this coagulation, they can undergo a change which is called the denaturation. Denaturation proteins, they are mostly very much soluble in the extremes of pH. So there's a maximum precipitation occurs at the isolytic pH of the protein. And again, these properties can be used to purify the proteins. Now we have amphoteric nature of proteins. So I've already told that the amino acid carries these amino and the carboxyl group in their side chains, which have an ability to go under the undergo the ionization. And then depending on the pH, they can act as donor or a proton donor or acceptor. So that's why these proteins are amphiolytes and act as both acids and bases. This we have already talked about the Zeutter ion, how they carry the equal number of positive and negative charges. The net charge then becomes zero, and how the acidic side of PI and the alkaline side of PI protein exist by accepting a protein or donating a protein so that they can migrate towards anode or cathode in electric field respectively. Then this particular property has a wonderful application that it is made use of an electrophoresis to separate different proteins depending on the charge present in them at a particular pH. And then we have a precipitation of proteins. So they can be precipitated from solution by a variety of positive and negative ions. And these precipitation has a particular importance in the isolation of protein, in the deproteinization of blood and other biological fluids, and extracts for analysis and in the preparation of useful protein derivatives. These are the most positive ions that can be commonly used. Are those of heavy metals that include zinc, calcium, and so forth. The biomedical application through this property is that the use of silver nitrate in cauterizes is based on this property. It precipitates the proteins of tissue as Ag salts, silver salts. Another application is the use of protein as antidotes to metallic poisons. Egg white, milk, and other proteins can be used to precipitate the metal ions as well. Now, there's a negative ion precipitation. Here it involves the tungstic acid, trichloroacetic acid, tannic, ferrocyanic, and sulfosalic acid. They have their own application in the clinic as they're commonly used for the preparation of protein-free filtrate of blood and other biological materials prior to analysis of few constituents such as sugar, urea by the specific methods. Now we have color reactions of the protein. So we know that the proteins produce color in certain reaction, and these reactions are not quite specific for a protein molecule such but due to the characteristic group of a particular amino acid that is present. So these are involved as enthalpotic reaction. It is basically when you add an alkali, there is a precipitate that turns orange due to the nitration of the particular aromatic ring. So that's how you can use this property. There is a Millen's test where you use a reagent called Millen's reagent. Here it is a molecular chloride of 10% sulfuric acid, and then in that case, if you add NaNO2, the precipitate turns pink red. Then you have a biurity reaction, which is a wonderful reaction, which is basically used to determine to like how much protein is present in your solution. It is due to the coordination of cupric ions with the unshared electron pairs of peptide nitrogen and the oxygen of water, which forms a color coordinated coordination complex. Then we have a ninhydrin reaction. This is a powerful oxidizing agent, ninhydrin, and it plays a very important, it causes the actually oxidative decarboxylation of the alpha amino acids. So what happened is the reduced ninhydrin hydrin 10 molecule reacts with ammonia, and it which has been liberated, and one molecule of ninhydrin forming a blue colored compound. So this is the again reaction, color reaction, which can be used for the protein determination and this quantification. This is a molecule of carbon dioxide is basically here evolved that indicates the presence of that your amino acid is the alpha amino acid. Now another is the nitroprusside reaction. These are the proteins with free sulfhydryl group of cysteine that gives the reddish color, which with the sodium nitroprusside chemical in the ammonical solution. Here many protein gives a test positive when there's a denaturation of the heat coagulation indicates that there's a liberation of free SH groups. And then we have a lead acetate test. Here it is very specific for the sulfur containing amino acids. So here you can have a sulfur a protein that contains a sulfur containing amino acid. If you boil it with a strong alkali, it will split out the sulfur as a sodium sulfide which further reacts with lead, and it gives a black precipitate of the sodium sulfide. So you will know that the amino acid and the protein is highly rich in the sulfur amino acid. Then we have a Sullivan reaction. It's basically when you want to determine cysteine and cysteine. And now after all the properties and the reactions, how we can determine. Now there is a structural organization of proteins. So there are four structural organization, that is primary, secondary, tertiary, and the quaternary structure. So here first we will talk about the helices and the bonds, which are involved in the conformation of the proteins, and the linkages of the bond, which are involved in the secondary structure formation of hydrogen bonds and the disulfide bonds. So basically, the primary structure is the structure of the protein which contains the amino acids. And here, for the secondary structure, the majors are hydrogen bond, and these are the properties here. And we have disulfide bonds, which basically form between the two cysteine residues. They are very strong, high energy in the covalent bonds. If you look at here, alpha helix, it is a peptide chain that forms a regular helical coil, which is called the alpha helix. So this is the structure which shows here. So this is the distance of 5.4 angstrom pitch. There are 3.6 amino acid residues per turn are present. So here this alpha helices can be either right-handed or left-handed. Left-handed alpha helix is less stable and then right-handed alpha helix, because of the steric interference between the C double O and the side chains, and only the right-handed alpha helix has been found in the protein structure. Now we have a beta pleated sheet structure. So here beta keratin is present in the spider's web, the epithelial claw, silk form, the fibers of the silk form the almost fully extended chain. And here basically, in case of the if you look at here, this is the structure of the beta chain. And then we have apart from this, we have a triple helix also. Here in that case, the collagen is very much rich in proline and the hydroxyproline, and they cannot form the alpha helix of the beta-pleated sheet. So here it forms the triple helix. Here the triple helix is stabilized by both, which is the covalent bonds as well as the non-covalent. And there is always an interchain hydrogen bonds that are present between the different peptide chains that are formed, which are almost perpendicular to the always the long axis of the alpha helix. In addition, there is an interchain additional crosslinks, and there are secondary amide bonds of the peptide bonds which are responsible for the triple helix. And many globular proteins, they have mixed secondary structure of alpha helix, beta plated sheet, and non-helical, non-plated structure, which are also, you must have heard about the term called random coil. Now we have a super secondary structure. These are the, again, as I mentioned, that there's a various combination of secondary structure that called super secondary structure, and they are found in the globular proteins. So here, if you could see, these are the beta alpha beta unit. There's a Greek key, beta meander. These are the different structures. So here, basically, these are the example of super secondary structure. Here, the beta alpha beta unit, it consists of two parallel beta pleated sheets, which are connected by an intertwining strand of alpha helix. Then we have a Greek key. It's another common super secondary structure. This is a conformation that takes its name from a design often found on a classical Greek pottery. And we have a beta meander. It consists of five beta pleated sheets which are connected by the reverse turns. And the beta meander basically contains nearly as many hydrogen bonds as an alpha helix, and its common occurrence probably reflects the stability that is conferred by this extensive hydrogen bonding. Now we have tertiary structures. Now the polypeptide chain that with secondary structure, they may be further folded, super folded, and they are twisted about itself, forming many sizes. So such a structural conformation is called tertiary structure. It is only one such conformation which is biologically active, and protein in this conformation is called as a native protein. The accessory structure is constituted by steric relationship and between the amino acids, which are located far apart, but they always drop together by the folding. So the bonds which are responsible for the interaction between the groups of amino acids are as follows, which are hydrophobic interactions. We have hydrogen bonds, ionic or electrostatic interactions, van der Waals forces, and the disulfide bonds. Now, if we move to the quaternary structure, many proteins are made up of only one peptide chain. However, when a protein consists of two or more peptide chains, they are held together by non-covalent interactions or by covalent crosslinks, and it is referred to as the quaternary structure. The assembly is often called as an oligomer, and each constituent peptide chain is called as monomer or a subunit. And these are the examples. For example, hemoglobin, lactate dehydrogenase, apoferritin, aspartate transcarboxylase, which has 72 subunits in structure, creatine phosphokinase, which have protein with two monomers. Now, there are proteins denaturation when we talk about the structure and how, like, what are the we know that there's a conformation of protein molecule which are always extremely sensitive to changes in their environment. So in denaturation, there's always a disruption of a native or a biologically active protein conformation when you tweak with the environment. So why it can happen, that it can be defined as a disruption of a secondary, tertiary, or wherever applicable quaternary organization of protein molecule due to cleavage of the non-covalent bonds. So the note here is that primary structure of protein molecule, that is the peptide bond, is never affected in this denaturation. So here the agents which cause the denaturations are physical as well as chemical. Physical, it can be heat, UV light, ultrasound, high pressure, violent shaking. So you'll observe these things when you are isolating a protein and when you have a pure amount of a protein. And when, for example, if you have it in a tube and if you shake it very vigorously, you'll see there is a lot of frothing will occur. That shows the solution contains the protein and there is a denaturation happening. Now the chemical agents are organic solvents. They could be alkalis or acids, urea, and most of the time it's various detergents. So when during the purification of a protein, you have to be very clear with your practical solutions and the apparatus which you're using. They're always supposed to be free with the detergents. Otherwise, they will hamper the purification of your protein. Now there are alteration in the protein molecules after denaturation that could be chemical, and the denaturation can be reversible. There could be a physical alterations. In that case, the rate of diffusion of the protein molecule decreases. Biological alterations, denaturation destroy their activity, the enzymatic and the hormonal activity. Now, criteria for the purity of proteins. They can be isolated, that can be tested by employing various methods, by solubility, molecular weight, ultracentrifugation as already discussed, electrophoresis, like electrophoretic mobility, and a homogeneous sharp level that indicates that protein is pure. So a chromatography, where the particles of a pure protein emerge out of the chromatography column as one single peak of eluvin. And also, like, if you look at here on the top, that by the solubility curve. So when you have a solute which is added repeatedly in increasing quantity to the solvent, the solute in solution rises proportionally and produces a sloping straight line. That is, it's in its solubility curve. So when the solution gets saturated, it fails to hold the solute in that solution any further. Thus, a single sharp peak break, occurs in a straight line, if you could see here in this, and at a saturation point. And more than one break in the line or a non-linear curve indicates that what is the homogeneity and the non-homogeneity of the sample. Apart from that, we have immunoreactivity, where the antibodies raised against a pure protein that show only one sharp spike on immunodiffusion or the immunoelectrophoresis methods. Now we have majorly we'll discuss here about the clinical aspects, like what are the diseases that are resulting from, why we are so concerned about the protein structure, what happened when there is an alteration in their conformation. So there's a disease called enzymus, which is a where the levels of the beta amyloid becomes elevated. Here, beta amyloid undergoes a conformational transformation, that is, from a soluble alpha helix rich state to it becomes a rich in beta sheet, and they much more prone to the self aggregation. Here, apolipoprotein E has been implicated as a potential mediator of this conformational transformation. We have prion diseases. They are basically rapidly progressive dementia sets in with neurological defects and ataxia. In human, this is called CJD. Other forms are GSSD and fetal familial insomnia. In animal, it produces crepy in sheep. BSE in cattle, it is also known as a mad cow disease. So here, these are the major disease that I have discussed, that what happens when there is a alteration in the altogether the protein conformation. So these are, you always hear about the disease, the enzymos and the protein disease. So this is all about protein structure, protein conformation, the alteration, and the clinical aspect of it. For more information about the protein structure in detail, you can refer these three wonderful books here, Leninger, Wharton, White, and Chatterjee et al. These are the wonderful books to refer for further studying about the proteins, amino acids, their structure, classification, and the function. Thank you.